Welcome to what I think is going to be a wonderful evening. We have a recital by an internationally renowned organist, Richard Pinel, to celebrate the completion of our project to restore and renovate our beautiful and historically important Mansfield organ. I'm really delighted to welcome you all here this evening. And as principal of the college, what I'm particularly excited about is the commitment here to ensure that the culture of music and arts really flourishes here at college. The chapel organ is one of the jewels in our crown and central to the musical life of Mansfield, and I'm delighted that after many years it's singing out in the chapel once more. I know that there are a lot of people here this evening who have put their hearts and souls truly into making and sustaining music at Mansfield, and I really want to thank you all for your commitment and for sharing your talent and time with us over decades. In the midst of the lockdown in 2020, there were no people in this college apart from me and my husband and my children, and one or two other people, but really very few. My then bursar and I took the opportunity to greenlight the restoration work to give the organ back its voice. So then the people who were here were us and the organ restorer working quietly away in a face mask. I know it's been a long-held ambition for a lot of people here over very many years, and to all of you who are here tonight, as well as those who couldn't be here, I really want to offer my sincere thanks for your generosity and indeed your patience in supporting our campaign to preserve this vital element of Mansfield's heritage and to enhance the musical life of college for our students and for our whole community. We've created a wonderful leather-bound book which is inscribed with the names of our supporters. I'd particularly like to thank Christine Ovenden, who I know can't be here tonight, but has worked so hard to ensure that there is a lasting record of the many people who have been so generous, and it will remain permanently on display in our beautiful chapel. There are a number of people I'd like to thank individually. Thank you, John Oxlade, our Emeritus Director of Music, who led on this effort for many years and whose talent and commitment has built such strong foundations for music at our college, and whom I first heard play our restored organ, and that was when I knew that lockdown really was going to end. And I want also to thank everyone particularly who served on the Organ Appeal Committee, John Ovenden, George Caird, Stephen Blundell, Curtis Rogers, Vicky Waters, Roshan Fahiri, and Helen Jones for initiating and seeing through this effort so very valiantly. And also to the Organ Appeal patrons, Paul Crossley, Edward Hickenbottom, Tony Lemon, and Thomas Trotter. Thank you all very much. Now, there is still some more work to be done. The organ is sounding fantastic, the new console is in place, and the restoration work by J.W. Walker and Company has been exemplary. But we couldn't do everything. We couldn't afford to do everything. So the complete works, phase two, will follow in time. And we also have very ambitious plans to sustain music at Mansfield by raising funds to endow and to forever secure the post of the Director of Music here. So for anyone who is minded to support this wonderful effort, there's more information about how you could do that in your programmes. Our Development Director, Tess McCormick, is here, wearing Ukrainian colours, kind of, and she can answer any questions or give you any forms, donation forms, if you feel inspired. It's very important to us that this concert is free and open to everybody to attend, so any donations for music towards Mansfield that you can make would be very welcome. We are really proud of the community at Mansfield, which is one of the most diverse communities of students of any Oxford college in every way. The great Stephen Blundell wrote of the organ in our most recent edition of the Mansfield magazine that it's the very embodiment of the principle that something uniquely beautiful is produced by a diversity of four voices. As always, Stephen, you're right. You're right about everything. So thank you all again who've made this long-awaited celebration possible. And now I'm going to hand over to Tom Hammond-Davis to introduce our artist tonight. Thank you, Tom.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Tom Hammond Davies. I'm the Director of Music here at Mansfield College, and it's a great pleasure to be in this role, having been an 18-year-old organist fresh out of school in 2003 up there. For about a year, I cut my teeth before I got an organ scholarship to Oxford, and this place has remained a very special place in my experience, my heart, my memory ever since. And so it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you tonight Richard Pinel, who took up the post of Director of Music at Jesus College, Cambridge in 2017. Before that, he spent nearly 8 years as Assistant Director of Music at St George's Chapel, Windsor Castle, during which time he gained international recognition as an organist. He also held similar posts at Magdalen College and Perth Cathedral in Australia, and the Organ Scholarship of St Albans Cathedral. Beginning his musical life as a chorister at All Saints Church, Northampton, Richard was awarded the prestigious Organ Scholarship to Magdalen College, Oxford in 2002. And it was during this time that we met. I was an undergraduate at Hartford, and Richard was there at my audition. During his time at Magdalen, the Grammy-nominated college choir undertook several recording projects on the Harmonia Mundi USA label, on which Richard's playing was hailed as a force of nature. Since then, Richard has enjoyed competition success on an international level, culminating in winning the first prize, Ad Wemes Prize, and Haji Hakim Prize at the Breda International Organ Competition in the Netherlands. As a teacher, Richard has led masterclasses for the Royal College of Organists, and his first CD, L'Orgue Symphonique, released on Resonance Classics, has been praised for its electric impact and truly tremendous verve. Recital engagements have taken him across the UK to Europe and the United States of America, and he's broadcast as both an organist and a pianist on Radio 3, BBC Radio 4, Classic FM, and Radio France Culture. Please give a warm welcome to Richard Pinel.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for such a warm welcome. Thanks to Helen and to Tom and everybody involved in making this evening happen. It's a real pleasure to be here. I have actually given an organ recital in this chapel before. I believe it was about 17 years ago. John Oxlade may remember better than I, but he very kindly invited me to play here. Back in the days when the organ was on its last legs, I think it would be safe to say, the organist could hide away up there on the old console and playing this beautiful piece of Victorian furniture, I suppose you would think of it. It's an amazing period piece, but hidden away from the listeners downstairs. I remember very little about the concert itself, apart from the organ being incredibly heavy to play. The keys were, it took a lot of physical effort to push down. And even back then, John, I know, had it in mind that something needed to be done to restore the organ to its former glory. So it's really exciting to see that is very much the case, or I think about approximately two-thirds of it is restored to its former glory. It's very nice as a performer to be able to sit down here, directly opposite the pipes, and get a truer idea of the balance between the different sounds, the different combinations of sounds. And it's also easier to judge what's happening out in the building than if you're tucked away up there. So it's a lot of fun to reacquaint myself with this instrument. I've chosen a programme today which I hope will show lots of the different colours, musical colours, that the organ can produce. Some of the pieces are contemporary with the instrument, so this instrument was originally built in 1890, I believe, and so a fair chunk of the music I'm playing would have existed then or was written soon after, so you might like to imagine that you're an audience sitting in these stalls 125 years ago or so, hearing contemporary music. However, organs are dynamic, changing, evolving instruments, and one of the reasons I'm particularly excited by this project is that these evolutions and changes, they very much go in fashions or fads. And in the, I think, 1950s, 60s, 70s, there was a very different fashion amongst organ builders and organists and listeners, and lots of instruments were either thrown on the scrap heap and replaced or butchered beyond recognition to kind of conform to these modern ideas of how organs should sound. I'm pleased to report that this kind of instrument is kind of very much back in fashion. And here you've got an original period piece that I think sounds very much as it did when it was built. So that's a really special thing. It's a special thing for the college, but also for Oxford, where there's a great ecosystem of different chapels and churches with hundreds of different types of organs. Here you've got a kind of one-of-a-kind original organ. So congratulations once again to the college for making this happen. You've just heard the Preludium in G minor by Buxtehude. He was... rather, these days, we often think of J.S. Bach being the father of the organ and organ music. When Bach was a young man learning his trade, going on his career, Buxtehude was the one they all looked up to, so much so that Bach, I think, walked something like 200 miles just to hear this great maestro. I think he took 2 weeks off work to make this walk, this pilgrimage, and he came back 3 months later, and his bosses were not very happy. However, that Preludium in G minor, it's all about rhetoric and musical arguments and developments, and I hope you heard that running through it, where it went from the opening flourish to an almost dance-like chaconne at the end. The next piece I'd like to play for you is César Franck's Prelude, Fugue and Variation. This was written in about 1862, so it's a bit older than this instrument. There's a bit of disagreement as to whether it was originally an organ piece or originally a duet for organ and harmonium. I tried to answer the question on Wikipedia earlier, but I found lots of conflicting answers. we know that it was published first as an organ piece in 1868, and the harmonium and piano duet was published in 1880. However, actually a lot of the left-hand writing you'll hear at the end of the piece, there are some running semiquavers in the left hand. It's actually much better suited to the shape of somebody's right hand. And in the harmonium piano duet, that part is in the right hand of the piano part. So I wonder if actually it was originally for that combination. But so you might like to cast your mind across the channel into a lovely French salon where you might have a nice glass of Burgundy or something in your hand, and there's a grand piano and there's a harmonium and these two musicians making music together. It's a really beautiful piece. I will follow that then by Mendelssohn's Andante in D major, which is a very charming little piece, 1844, so again a little bit older than this instrument. It's an original theme and a set of four quite loose variations, so you'll hear kind of references to that original theme in slightly different guises, and then it comes back again at the end. It's a sunny little number. Then I will play for you Jean Longlet's Triptyque. Jean Longlet was an amazing improviser. He would quite often just sit down at the keyboard and make up music on the spot, using quite strict musical forms. It really was composing on the fly rather than just playing a few nice chords. He was a blind organist, which I always just find amazing. Every time I sit down at a new instrument, it takes me quite a long time to work out where all of the different stops are, where the sounds are coming from, and so forth. And I really can't imagine being able to do that without my sight. So it's extraordinary to think. He was the organist of Saint Clotilde in Paris as a successor to César Franck. This triptyque is a really charming trio of pieces. The first movement, the melody, has an almost folk-like quality, this kind of modal harmony that just is evocative of folk music whilst not being strictly the case. At the end of that first movement, you hear the melody come back in a canon, so like a round, between the right hand and the pedals. Now the pedals on the organ usually play the low boomy notes, but in this case it's actually a quite high-pitched stop in the pedals. So if you could see me playing, you might imagine that it would be my hand quite high up on the keyboard, but it's actually the feet. So there's the first movement, the melody, then the trio, which is a kind of scampering scherzo. It's kind of full of humour. It's a Ministry of Funny Noises type piece, but I wanted to include it because it shows a different dimension to the wonderful sounds on this instrument. And then the finale of the triptyque is a kind of fairly robust, slightly manic, slightly fun again. There's a familiar theme that appears about halfway through, again in the pedals, but this time on the low boomy notes. So I shall play for you now some Franck, some Mendelssohn, and some Longlet, and then I'll come and talk to you again about the rest of the programme. Thank you. We now have two final pieces to hear. Before I speak about those, I should just thank once again Tom and Helen and everybody for making me feel welcome. It's an unusual experience to have such an august musician as Tom standing following the music as I play. So it's he's being my page turner, which thanks to modern technology actually involves pushing a button on a remote control. I'm very lucky to have such a fine musician at my elbow. So thank you, Tom. So the final two pieces, the Lied by Vienne. Lied being German for song, of course. Vienne, Louis Vienne, was the organist of Notre Dame in Paris. Like Jean Langlais, he was almost completely blind and yet used to manage this enormous five-manual organ in Notre Dame Cathedral. To explain, this instrument here, if you were to go upstairs, has three keyboards, three manuals, plus the one for the feet. The console downstairs has two. Currently, though I noticed that the organ builder has left room for a third manual when the rest of the restoration takes place. But if you imagine sitting at a console with five different keyboards, you really have to stretch to reach the top one and stops everywhere. So Vienne used to manage that on a day-to-day basis. And he wrote some very large-scale symphonic music, but also some beautiful miniature character pieces, of which this is one. So it's a song without words, if you will. And then finally, the Fantasia and Fugue by Parry. That was written in 1877 and revised to the version that you'll hear today in 1913. So again, very much contemporary with this instrument. You will see from the programme that I've played two pieces called Fugue today. Some of you, I know, are well aware what a fugue is. If you're not so aware, a fugue is a bit like a musical conversation. So it tends to start off with one voice, could be played by a single instrument, and then a second voice joins in, playing essentially the same melody. There are some complicated rules about which keys the melodies come in, but the same melody, and then a third voice enters with the melody again. And so it's a contrapuntal piece, many voices, that means. So instead of playing chords or a melody with one hand and chords and a bass line, there are, I think in this piece, a four-part fugue. So essentially I'm doing the job of four musicians, and you hear that initial opening melody kind of thrown around between voice to voice. It's kind of quite fun to listen and see where you can hear it next. It's one of my absolute favourite pieces. It was, in fact, written for one of my predecessors in Windsor, where I used to play it and imagine Walter Parrott, his name was, who used to teach at the Royal College of Music, and then he would jump on presumably a steam train back to Windsor for evensong each day. He was one of the great organists of his day, and lots of music was written for him. I think this Parry in particular, of all of the pieces I've played today, is where this instrument feels most at home, and I think you can kind of hear that right from the very first note even. So I hope you've enjoyed what you've heard. I hope you'll continue to enjoy some Vienne and some Parry, and thank you again for all of your support this evening of this wonderful project and this concert. So thank you very much. Thank you.